I don't know how come, but the Real Sounds of Africa there with Football Fan sounds even better than it sounded last week, or the week before, or the week before that. It gets better every time we play it, doesn't it? 0808 590 693 is the number to call if you'd like to join in the conversation. 0808 590 693. As you heard that little chuckle there a moment ago, that is at Paul Sears, or if you prefer, the Galata Sears, as we call him, our European football expert for this morning, and an expert on players from over there playing in our leagues as well. Paul, good morning.
Good morning, Dotun. Good morning.
Hi. You're on the same side of the water as the Legendinho this time, you know.
I do know now, but I didn't know before now. Otherwise, I'd be there. Yeah. I'd be there with him.
He's brought his suntan with him. Yeah. And I can't quite figure out if he's brought the gold medallion, but he's brought the hairy chest, obviously. He's brought the hairy chest back over.
Well, that medallion won't be far behind. We know that by now.
Well, that's by way of saying welcome home, Legendinho.
Thank you very much. Lovely to be here. Very struck by that story that we heard in the last few minutes about origami in space.
Yeah, I thought you ruined
it. Yeah. NASA's gone funky. NASA's gone soul. It's the beginning of the end.
Yeah, of course. It's a funky NASA kind of thing. Absolutely. Okay, let's talk football. 0808 590 693. Feel free to pick up the phone and give us a call. Talk football in Europe and South America, players from over there playing in our leagues, and anything else you'd like to talk about as well with the Legendinho and Paul Sears. So, should we start, Paul, with Morata, or is Virgil van Dijk a potentially bigger story?
Well, I mean, they're both big stories, but I think they're probably stark in their contrast that about being sort of opposite ends of the transfer window spectrum, you know.
Well, let's do Virgil van Dijk then, because Tim can come in on this as well. The prospect is that Virgil van Dijk will not play for Southampton again. He's training on his own. He wants a big transfer move. It looked like Liverpool were going to sign him, and then the FA stepped in and said you didn't do it properly, so Liverpool backed off. But the player's head has already been turned, and you know, we have experience of this, don't we, where a player goes on strike. That's essentially what he has done at Southampton. I can't help thinking of... No, you disagree, would you?
Well, I mean, it's... I don't know if necessarily that's exactly what it is. I mean, he's obviously said to Pellegrino and said to the board there that he wants the move. And it's been the manager's decision to make him train on his own. The manager said this week he's not 100% psychologically. I want players, you know, the same old sort of tired old cliches that are true in a lot of the cases. I want players that are committed to playing for this club, playing, you know, training every day. I need people to be at 100%, and if he's got his mind elsewhere, then obviously he's not got his mind completely on the job at hand. And I wouldn't say that he's gone on strike. I'm not sure that that's fair, but it's part of the course, really, that when a player wants to move, then...
We've seen it with Sadio Berrino when he was at West Brom. That effectively was a strike, wasn't it? He said, I don't want to play for you lot anymore.
He did, but it came out then after his move that he was actually serving a ban at the time that nobody knew about while it was all going on. So again, I mean, we only know very sort of limited details about all of these situations. But I wouldn't say that that Van Dijk has gone on strike as many other players have in the past to force through a move. Okay. He's just made it known to the powers that be that he wants to move, and they've decided to make him train on his own or with the reserves or however they're going to deal with it going forward.
Legendinho, what happens in South America? Because we know, and we speak to you every week, and you tell us about all these players from South America who are being, who have gone, noticed by European football clubs. And then the moment they offer loads and loads of money, their heads get turned. And sometimes, of course, it won't work out. What happens in South America generally then? Do the players cooperate with their existing club, or have their heads been turned so much that they can't get back?
What makes it a little bit different is that usually in South America, the club are desperate to sell as well. And that they might, for their supporters, put up a front of not wanting to sell, but usually they want to sell. And it really has become an exports industry. I was thinking just about this the other day, and I've been based there now since 1994. And when I first moved out there, the first few games that I saw, I was so privileged to see some of the talent. I mean, the one I remember really leaping out to me was Roberto Carlos, who was early 20s. And, you know, I saw him at left back for Palmeiras, and it was like, what on earth is this? How comes no one has discovered this? These days, someone of that ability would, at that age, would already have been across the Atlantic. So the whole thing in South America these days is almost built on the basis of being an export industry. And sometimes, at my most cynical, I sometimes think that the organisational problems of South American football, there's a component of that in that some people inside the game want it to fail because it creates the necessity to sell more players with the possibility of then money going into private bank accounts. I think that there's a generally international awareness that a player who doesn't want to play for you is a pretty useless asset. You can't get a great deal from him, can you? You can gamble with the thing of, well, all right, he has a vested, if we don't sell him, he has a vested interest to keep putting an effort in over the next 6 months before the next transfer window. But that's that doesn't get someone who's willing to go the extra mile, willing to do his shift and cover for the other guy. So usually a player who wants out can force his way out.
You see, it's a very lonely place, isn't it, Paul, for somebody, a player from overseas to, okay, let's not say refuse to cooperate, but a player who, from overseas who wants to leave a club, who has shown already that they're interested, or some other club has shown interest in them, and they've said that, you know, I want to leave this club, I want to go somewhere else. It's a very lonely place for them, I would have thought, because they're taking these big decisions where they can both, they can come a cropper very easily, but also they can't quite ever feel the love of the fans and the team that they want to sort of get a transfer from.
Yeah, I mean, that's all true. But, you know, I mean, I'm playing devil's advocate to a certain extent, because I know that if a player went on strike at my club to try and agitate for a move, it wouldn't go down very well. I don't think it goes down very well with supporters everywhere. But I think that's also because we as supporters of football clubs have a slightly nostalgic view of how football should be. And it's not like that anymore. And, you know, Southampton are a club historically that have been very successful in developing and selling on players for big profits. They will not lose out if they sell Virgil van Dijk, because they'll get a world record fee for a defender of 60 million, which if he goes within the next week, it will be three times in 10 days that record has been broken.
Crazy.
Well, I mean, it's just reflective of the new money that's come in. Yeah. This is the thing, Dotun. A lot of people have read a lot of stuff this week about how the Premier League has gone crazy this summer. But I mean, I think personally that it went crazy a long time ago. And now we're just seeing sort of the next level of TV money kicking in, meaning that, you know, if Southampton don't want to sell Van Dijk, they've got the money. They don't have to. They don't have to sell him now. They've got enough money from TV revenue.
Well, they do have to sell him, is what Tim was saying, because, you know, having an uncooperative footballer is a waste of time.
It's a waste of time and it's a waste of money, but it's also a waste of time for Virgil van Dijk. If he doesn't want to play for Southampton and Southampton don't want to sell, then there's a very real prospect that he'll sit in the reserves for a year. You know, there's a World Cup next summer. That's the last thing that he will want to do. He will want to be playing football. Of course, he wants to play it elsewhere. But if he doesn't get that move, then you know, a peace offering will have to be made from one side or the other, because he's too good to be wasted in the reserves. And from his perspective, on a personal level, you know, it's the World Cup next summer, and you know, should they make it, of course, he'll be desperate to be involved.
I was going to ask who you blame, both of you, for this stalemate, but let's leave that to one side, because I'm bring Uber in London into the conversation. Good morning, Uber.
Hi, Dan. How's it going?
Very well, thanks very much. Good to meet you, mate.
Yeah, good to meet you, mate. So, how's it going, Tim? How's it going, Paul?
Very well,
yes,
thank you.
Yes, very well, thank you. Cheers.
Great. So basically, I wanted to ask a question about supporters. Can either of the experts sort of think of a set of supporters that capture their sort of home city or town's provincial identity and culture in the sort of most interesting way?
Ah, that's a good question. I like that. I do. Tim, do you want to go first? Supporters that capture the home team's identity and culture.
Yeah, the city, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's always very difficult to do this with one club because a city, by its definition, is diversity. You know, as one of the Greek philosophers said, all good things flow to the city and a fair few bad things as well. I'm intrigued a little bit by Paris Saint-Germain, for example. What, you know, it's the only big club in a huge city. And I know that they've had problems with the diverse identities of Paris and perhaps antagonistic identities of Paris under the same roof. Because, you know, you've got racists and immigrants together. And I can imagine that's it's difficult to construct an identity from that. So always with the big cities, you're looking for different clubs to celebrate, to commemorate different aspects of that city. The big contrast for me in my adopted city of Rio is between Fluminense and Vasco da Gama. Now, Fluminense are the first, really. They're the first football club. And it's very, very aristocratic because football started very much with the elite. It was seen as a thing for rich first world people, and Fluminense really have that. And their stadium, which they don't use anymore, it looks like an English cricket pavilion. And look, it's gorgeous actually, and there's a function room there with a kind of glass windows. You think you're in an elaborate cathedral.
What were you doing in the function room? Weren't you supposed to be reporting on the match
I was filming, actually, with a film crew, if that's all right. I was working.
Yeah.
Good try. So it's beautiful. So you're really...
Like cricket. He loves it.
Exactly. Very good.
So you're really getting an air there of oldie-worldie Rio elite, European-influenced Rio elite. Then across town, in the working-class north zone, you've got Vasco da Gama. Now, their stadium... And Vasco are a club set up by the Portuguese immigrants. But not thank you. Oh no!
Waiting for that.
Yeah, he was a bit slow there.
I think
he got a couple of biscuits in first before reaching for his special effects button.
Exactly.
Even more than being a Portuguese team, Vasco were a working class team. And they came from this working class area with a team including poor whites and blacks, and that really put the cat amongst the pigeons, and that really did. And the elite clubs, they did all sorts of things to try and stop Vasco from being in the first division. And one of the things they did, I mean, one was to force the players to fill out forms before taking the field. And at that time, we're talking the 1920s, the early 1920s, the majority of Brazilians were illiterate. So they just couldn't, you know, wouldn't. So Vasco responded by sending their players to school. Then there was another demand. The club, in order to participate in the Rio First Division, you have to have a stadium. And so Vasco clubbed together, you know, little Portuguese businessmen they own, like dry cleaners and stuff like that, and bakeries. They clubbed together and they built this stadium, which has just gone 90 years old this year, San Januario. And it's a totally, totally different atmosphere from the Fluminense Stadium. It's a working class area, which, in fact, over time has become an underclass area. Go on, Uber, mate.
No. Would you say from that they have taken that culture into the stands then?
Well, so they're then set up as a kind of opposition to Fluminense. So you've got that class split, but then comes the 1930s, and the 1930s is vital. It's a vital decade for Brazilian society and a vital decade for Brazilian football. And in the 1930s, after the Wall Street crash of 29, when Brazil is just a big farm, really, just selling raw material abroad, and then with the Wall Street crash and the World Depression, there's a collapse of demand for Brazil's produce, so it has to develop internally. So a new president comes in with an idea. It's a relatively benign version of tropical fascism. Let's develop the country while maintaining the existing social structure. And the club, it was inclusive as well. It was the first time that the idea of the black Brazilian is included in the national image. It's the time where samba, which had been persecuted, becomes the soundtrack of Brazil, becomes officially sanctioned. And the club who most represent this, who are most in harmony with this political development, are Flamengo, who up until that time had been an elite club. And they had a visionary president who saw which way the political wind was blowing. And they went on a project to be popular. They signed the leading three black players of the day. And they built up an elite support. And there was a real link. And they've really worked hard to forge a link between the club, Flamengo, and Brazil. And Brazil in those days meant Rio more than anything else, because Rio was the capital. So they are the mass team. They're also the mass team all over. When I flew back last week, I flew first from Rio to Salvador in Bahia. That's a two-hour flight north, and a little wait there at Salvador Airport. And while I was waiting there, a fellow recognised me from your TV stuff, and he comes over across and said, yeah, me and my family, we come from a rural place, and a fellow who works in the airport. We come from the countryside here in Salvador, and we are all fanatical Flamengo fans. And I'm saying, well, you know, you've got teams locally here. No, it was Flamengo, because it was the games of Flamengo that were coming on the radio. And we could relate to the team. You know, it was my granddad or someone who first got into it. We could relate to the team. So I think when you see Flamengo, especially when it's Flamengo at the Maracanã, there's all levels of Brazilian society in there. And I think it's the team that most captures. It also captures a kind of, you know, Rio has that thing of being the former capital, and, you know, by far the best known place in Brazil. And it has that kind of arrogance about it. It's a city which considers itself important. And there's a lot of that in Flamengo. And Flamengo are the kind of club where they put together three consecutive wins. And, we're going to be South American champions. We're going to play Barcelona in the final of the World Club Cup. You know, they've got almost delusion going on all the time. And this year in the Copa Libertadores, South America's Champions League, they haven't won it since. They only won it once in 1981. And this year, when they're in it again and they're playing their home games, full stadium, full Maracanã, and the stadium is full of banners saying 1981, 2017, as if it's an absolute foregone conclusion that they're going to win it again, they get knocked out in the group phase. And there's something quite Flamengo about that, I think. You know, having it's almost like, it's a bit like Tottenham were a few years ago. You know, as a Tottenham fan, our kind of delusions of grandeur. It's a bit like Tottenham were a few years ago, only multiplied many times over.
Are you still talking, Tim? Are you still talking?
Why? Are you still awake?
Paul Serres has been waiting patiently to come on a World Football Phoning. Good morning to you, Paul.
Well,
long time listener.
I'm taking advantage of the fact there are no cracks in the line. You know, you can hear me.
Yeah. A long time listener, are you, Paul?
I am. Yeah, very. It feels much longer than normal this morning for some reason.
Yeah. Well, whilst we're at it, before you get on to answer the other side of the question that Uber asked, and just bear with us, Uber, I've got to throw this one in because Tim's already mentioned that I've been quite late on the buzzer, and I'm a little bit late with this one. But you know your interest in origami, Tim?
Yeah, it's with the odd pocket square. You know,
yeah,
I try.
Of course. No, yeah. Fair enough. But a question to all of you, and Uber, you can join in this one as well. What's the origamist favourite football team?
Swansea? I don't know.
Swansea? Mm. Swansea?
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of one with Fold in it. I can't.
Me too.
Yeah.
I've got their favourite snooker player.
Foldham Athletic.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, thanks to Judith in Lincolnshire with that. Sorry.
These are jokes, folks.
Yeah. Well, we've done that one. So what about from your perspective in Europe? Are there any supporters who express themselves in a culturally relevant way that tells us something about the culture of the football club?
Well, I think, yeah, I mean, I think, you know, Tim hit the nail on the head, I think, in that you need two sides or more if the city can sort of hold more clubs to really show the diversity and to represent a city truly. And the one that popped into mind was not European, but it was Akli against Zamalek in the Cairo Derby, where on one side you have the poor, devout, working class, and on the other you have a board of directors that very often mirror the people running the country at the same time. And you know, it's a massive rivalry, but the two sets of supporters could not be sort of socially more different to each other. But in terms of a team, a support representing a city, the first one that came to mind were Feyenoord in Rotterdam. You know, Rotterdam is a huge port city. It's a working class city, and you know, the Dutch gave an awful lot to the world in terms of football, but they took quite a lot from the English footballing culture. I think a lot of places did around the world, and maybe still continue to do so. But they took that working class element of following a football team from the English, I think, from the English old first division. And it's still got that when you go to a game at the Kuip, it's still got that sort of that air of wildness about it. It's not, you know, you go to a game now in England in the Premier League, and you know, you're not even allowed to stand up without a steward coming over and telling you to sit down. And you know, it's become very sanitized, very very clinical experience now to go watch a football match in England, certainly.
Well,
certainly, hopefully safe standing will resolve that if we ever get around to that actually happening. I know it's happening.
I was going to say, it's not all over England, but at the Etihad Stadium, the stewards come and tell you to sit down, are they?
Well, you make light of it, Dotun, but this is the case increasingly now with every stadium.
Even while he's commentating.
I know.
And, yeah.
He doesn't only support them. He earns money from them as well. He's got to declare an interest two times over.
Thankfully, none of you heard my attempt at a Manc accent there. And moving on very swiftly, by the way, Uber, what about here in the UK then? Are there clubs for you that display the culture of their club? Fans displaying the culture of the club.
I suppose, I mean, I'm a Liverpool fan, but obviously you probably heard from my Midland accent that it's not where I'm from.
But the Scousers is a good one. Yeah, that's a good one, yeah. Isn't it?
I mean, the one that I immediately go to was, though, my dad's a big Villa fan. Please refrain, Tim, from the impressions just for a second.
Just for a second. Just hold back for a second, yeah.
But yeah, I think there's kind of I'd call it like a very self-deprecating city, Birmingham. And I think you hear a lot in the sort of chants, like, I don't know, my dad's highlight of last season was Gabby Abumahor's goal against the Blues. But it was kind of because it's the humour in it that he found, that he really, really enjoyed. And I don't know. And I think even from Blues fans as well, like, I mean, I don't think it's actually okay to say a lot of their songs on radio, but a really sort of self-deprecating. It's like the joke is always on them because, I mean, if the rest of the country are going to laugh at us, we may as well laugh at ourselves as well.
But isn't it interesting?
I think that's probably an English thing, Uber, more than anything. You know, gallows humour is rife in football stadiums around the country. And you know, you tend to, certainly following, declaring an interest here 28 minutes in, following Manchester City during the bad times, it was almost as though the atmosphere was sort of better, you know, and the football became sort of largely irrelevant.
But isn't it interesting, though, that the conversation has defined culture in terms of class culture, whether it be in South America or be in Egypt, to a certain extent here in the UK as well. Manchester City, for example, are seen as more kind of working class. And it's funny. You know, City fans are more like Oasis than Manchester United fans. Are they? Hang on, our studio director's a Cockney red. he's a genuine red. Is that true? Is Manchester United the posh lot up here? It's a myth, apparently. It's a myth. Well, that's my impression of that myth. And the same, I suppose, in Liverpool, Uber, that. I suppose Liverpool versus Everton. Is it Liverpool the more kind of working class team to Everton or not?
I don't know.
I think both Manchester clubs and both Liverpool clubs that have their roots firmly entrenched in working class areas, in Moss Side for City or Gorton before that, then Moss Side, then, you know, in Salford for for United.
The origins are sectarian, though, aren't they, in both Liverpool and Manchester? The origins.
There was that really, really interesting kind of clash that happened like towards the end of the season when it was in the last home game of the season, Liverpool fans brought out a banner of Jeremy Corbyn on the cop. And there was a real clash between, like, on the internet, there was quite a lot of sort of your sort of modern day fans saying, why are we bringing politics, Liverpool fans saying, why are we bringing politics into football? And then there was a real sort of lash out from the other side saying, like, I mean, this is Liverpool. I mean, it's such a political club anyway. How can you say that after, obviously, everything that's happened with the Hillsborough inquest? I mean, it is definitely, I mean, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I suppose I'm kind of saying that. My own question was nonsense, but...
I thought it was a really good question, actually. I thought it was a really good question. And I'm sorry to bring the conversation to an end because I'm looking at the clock a moment ago. Well, and Yuba, thanks a lot. Make sure you call another time as well. Great question.
BBC Five Live.
Durham 911, what is your emergency?
1810 Cedar Street, please.
What's wrong?
My wife's had an accident. She's still breathing.
What kind of accident?
Tell them stairs.
Beyond Reasonable Doubt, the programme, the podcast. Coming soon from Five Live.
BBC.
Radio Five Live.
Five Live.
This is BBC Five Live, available on the BBC iPlayer radio app. Up all night with Dotun Adebayo.
And we're all over the side of the Atlantic for a change. The Legendinho's over here. Take care of any questions you've got on South American football and players from over there playing in our leagues. And the Galatasaray's is here as well, answering any questions you've got on European football and players from over there playing in our leagues. But typical Galatasaray's, he's been talking about Egyptian football. Nowhere near Europe, of course, but he has embraced that for our conversation. And Joseph in Vigo in Spain. You never know, Joseph. Your question to Galatasaray's, he might go and answer a question about Australian football. You never know. Try your luck. Good morning.
Yeah, you never know, or it could come back to Man City.
You know him well. You
all
know
right,
him
Joe,
well.
All right, Joe.
Yes.
I was going to ask, though, there's been a massive scandal in Spain this week where the head of the FA, his son, so many other officials have been arrested on charges of embezzlement and various other stuff, which I won't really go into. But what really struck me, and it was on the BBC actually that I saw this first, was that his son, who was arrested, was serving, Gorka Villar was serving for Conmebol last year. And there was a litany of accusations, accused of extorting Uruguayan clubs, which I'd never heard of before personally. I was wondering, because it's all tied into the FIFA scandal as well, how was this playing in South America, given that direct CONMEBOL connection? So I wanted to ask that of Tim. And of Paul, I just wanted to know, across Europe, is this getting much play? Because, you know, I've only seen, you know, the BBC seems to have done a better job of reporting it than most, but it's, you know, all the transfers and everything, it doesn't really seem to have registered.
Let's take Tim first. You're nodding in agreement there.
Yeah, Gorka Villar, the son of is it Angel? Gorka Villar was the director general of CONMEBOL is South America's UEFA equivalent. He was a director general for about 18 months until July of last year, and then he was sacked. So this, and CONMEBOL are desperate to try and present themselves as a new organisation, nothing to do with the past, new, transparent. They're even getting in new logos. You know, they're doing everything that they can to try and distance themselves from the past. Because that FIFA Gate scandal, you know, when they all got arrested in Switzerland, really, it was a scandal of the Americas, really. It's a scandal of South America and Central America, and especially that nexus between the rise of cable TV and South American football. So the fact that this has happened in Spain has been widely reported in South America, and CONMEBOL have come out with statements and declarations and official notifications saying he has nothing to do with our organisation. He hasn't been there for a while. It's a very strange connection. And I'll throw in another one, which is the connection between former president of Barcelona and the former president of Brazil's FA, Ricardo Teixeira, who they're getting accused together as well. In fact, the warrant has just come from Spain for the arrest of Teixeira, who, after being in the States for a while, has gone back to Brazil. I'll just quickly tell a story about Teixeira, which I think illustrates the caliber of people who have been getting involved with South American football. I translate, working for the Panorama News and Current Affairs. It's a TV program, News and Current Affairs on the BBC. This is back just before the 1998 World Cup. And Teixeira at that time is the president of Brazil's FA, the CBF. That's an important position. It's a really important position in the country. Brazil, the team are out there in the hills outside Rio preparing for that year's World Cup. And we went and did an interview and I translated. And at the time, there was a lot of controversy. I can never remember.
Are you a Yank or a Brit?
Yeah, well, I'm not certainly not a Yank. I don't know what I am anymore. Yeah. But anyway, about the deal between the Brazil's FA and Nike, you know, Nike, which became even more controversial with the events of the World Cup final. And it was either the second or the third question that I translated to Teixeira. How does the CBF spend the money that you receive from Nike? It's a question that a seven-year-old child could answer. You know, there's absolutely, in fact, there's no malice in the question because there was no evidence behind it. You know, you answer the question, well, we invest in our structure and so on and so on. But instead of that, Teixeira just waved his arms around and started yelling, no more answers, no more questions. Now, television is told through images. And the image that this told was of someone who is not 100%. And the producer of the Panorama, he just couldn't believe his luck. You know, this was so good for the program because, you know, you almost got some kind of confession here of strange goings on, which would seem to be confirmed by Teixeira's involvement in the FIFA Gate scandal and the warrant which has arrived in the last few hours from Spain for his arrest. So, you know, on the way back to Rio, the producer was saying, look, you know, the president of Brazil's FA, this is a really important position. And how can someone so clearly stupid be filling this position? And I told him, well, welcome to Brazil and welcome to South America in general. You will find many, many very highly competent, highly trained people. But so often those in leadership don't have those qualifications.
And do you want to give us the Spanish background to all of this, Paul?
Well, I think Joseph's probably better placed to give the Spanish background. But in answer to the question, I think, I mean, it has got coverage, but probably not as much coverage as the accusations would normally warrant. And I think Joe touched on it, and Joe's point that at the time of the year that it's come, column inches are reserved for other things that are much more likely to entice readers into reading various publications. And also, I think that there is a general collective, what's the word I'm looking for? I think people have just been so saturated by stories of corruption at the highest levels in football, not just in, you know, South America, not just in CONMEBOL and CONCACAF regions, but across the world. And at home here, I think people have just become desensitized to the gravity of the situation. I mean, I saw that Villar and his son have been remanded in custody today without being given bail. So these are really serious charges that that the Spanish state are looking to bring against them. I mean, is it a big story? Yes. Is anybody really surprised? I don't think that there's anything that happens in football administration anymore that is genuinely surprising for football supporters who seem to love the game in spite of the people in charge. And very often we see people using football for their own personal gain, as seems to be the case, or certainly seems to be the basis of the accusations in this situation with VR. And I think it's a sad indictment on the game and the way the game is consumed at this time of the year, that this is not the preeminent story around Europe and various rumours of transfers and, you know, Neymar for 200 odd million euros, etc., are going to take the column inches at the moment. And that's, unfortunately, football is escapism. We don't necessarily want to, we find it distasteful to see those in positions of power within the game acting in similar ways to those in positions of power in society. And I think that people feel almost more offended when they take advantage of the game than others doing the same thing in different industries. So it's a massive story that hasn't got anywhere near as much coverage. But I'm sure, again, some of that is probably for legal reasons. These are only accusations at the moment. And it's difficult, really, to speak about the ills, the alleged ills of certain people without the facts.
Yeah, Joseph, thank you very much. 0808 599 693 is the number to call. If you'd like to join in the conversation, 0808 599 693. A lot of people have been responding to the previous caller, Uber, asking for fans who, in their way of being, their celebration, the way that they respond inside the stadium and otherwise, reflect the cultural perhaps background of the club that they support. Anyway, John has sent an email saying that, and Liverpool fans, you might want to comment on this as well, by the way. He says, Everton are called the people's club. Most football clubs in England have a working class base. Class in the UK crosses more across different sports. The middle and higher classes have tended to prefer, e.g. tennis, cricket and rugby union. Yeah, but Everton, the people's club? Yeah, is that how?
Yeah.
Rather than Liverpool, then.
Well, they are the people's club. It's one of their, not necessarily a nickname, but that's how they're known, yeah.
Is it controversy or controversy for you, Paul?
Controversy.
Controversy, yeah? No, it's controversy, mate. Sorry. You got that wrong immediately, didn't you?
Well, not the first.
You should have found a friend. lots of other questions on the World Football phone. This is a long one. Okay, let's try for this one. Kick back, folks. I might be some time, as somebody once famously said. This is from Dan. He says, I've been listening to the podcast for at least 8 to 10 years now, and I've loved every minute of it. I was tuned into Tim's work when he went on the old World Football phone-in. Old World Football phone-in? Was there an old one? I was turned onto Tim's work. Old World Football phone-in, Tim. Do you remember that? The old one?
It's all one stream of consciousness. Isn't it?
We've heard that. It was turned into it in the mid-2000s when I was a teenager. And since then, I've gone to college, moved away from home, gotten a job as a sports journalist. More on that in a moment. And got married, all with the World Football phone-in as an accompaniment on runs or train rides, car rides, long days at work, etc. On to my question. I live and work in Louisville, Kentucky, home of Muhammad Ali.
Ali territory.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
As a sports journalist for the big paper here, and I cover the local soccer football team, Louisville City FC. Some listeners in England may remember the coach, James O'Connor, from his time in the Championship with Stoke, West Brom, Burnley and Sheffield Wednesday. The team also has a few British and Irish players, including a Spurs Academy graduate, Cameron Lancaster, and a West Ham Academy graduate, Paco Craig, whose dad, Mikey Craig, played bass in the band Culture Club. Like we've forgotten. Yes. Of course we know that. Eric, the local team is in the second division North American League called the United Soccer League or USL. In the last 3 years, the league has grown in leaps and bounds, mostly due to rapid expansion, as there are now 30 teams in the league, as well as an increased financial commitment from owners, which is really raising the level of play. Crowds are also on the rise. Cincinnati is drawing more than 30,000 for some games, and friendlies, while Louisville City, playing in an 11,000-seater stadium, is averaging around 8,000 a game. Still strong numbers for a team that's only 3 years old. I'd like to know from the panel if any of the second divisions in their regions are looking at what's happening in the United States as a blueprint to grow their brand and level of play, or whether they just serve as the backstop to the first division and a place to discard the worst teams in the top division every year, because we do know that that doesn't happen in the States. I'd love to call in sometime, he says. So, Tim, South America, is it a place that can benefit from a US model, or is it just a dumping ground for teams that don't match the top division?
Well, the rise of football in the United States and clearly presents South American football with an opportunity. There's such different traditions, which is why I was saying a couple of weeks ago that for all of the logistical problems, I can really see the point behind a proposal of a Champions League for the Americas, because of the synergies that involved. South America has the tradition but doesn't have the economic momentum. United football in the United States is exactly the opposite. It has momentum, but it kind of still lacks a little bit of credibility because it's new and is finding its feet. But from what we're hearing there, it's finding its feet very, very successfully. I'm a bit puzzled by that, the concept of a second division in the USA, because they don't have the promotion and relegation type format. So I think for anyone outside that culture, it just doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. And where do you go? Where do you go if you win it? I'm not sure what the answer is to that question. And obviously, you know, the point of second divisions around South America and around the rest of the world is to promote teams to the first division and receive teams that are relegated as part of that pyramid structure. So I'm a little bit at a loss to know how in South America or anyone else could approach the US for a business model with this kind of self-standing second division. And what happens in this US second division if you win it? You know, you don't get promoted. What happens?
It's interesting though, Paul, that even though we talk about second divisions and third divisions and whatever divisions, how wonderful, we operate four divisions in here in England, at least four divisions, which get publicity, etc. But around the world, do second divisions around Europe, do they matter that much? Even though we sometimes say that there will be some small leagues where their Premier League, their top division, isn't equivalent to our top division. It might only be equivalent to, let's say, the Championship or the First Division or the Second Division, what we used to call the Fourth Division in this country. That will still get more notice because it's the top division of, say, Luxembourg or wherever it might be. In the United States, we only care about Major League Soccer. We don't care about the other divisions, do we? Even though Major League Soccer isn't really up to the level of our Premier League. But it's the top leagues that get the attention. Everything else is just by the by, surely.
Well, I mean, it's. I mean, Tim, again, has hit the nail on the head. The whole point of the whole raison d'etre of clubs in the lower leagues is to, you know, is to make it up the ladder. And once you get to the Premier League, you know, you then your reason for existence changes. In the USL, if you win the title, you continue to play in the USL. And it doesn't look as though, I mean, it doesn't look as though anytime soon there will be any kind of promotion and relegation between Major League Soccer and the USL. And I know that there's a huge debate about it. We've spoken about it before, and I know that John Arnold has spoken at length about it on the programme. But I don't think that European second tiers can look towards the US as an example. Yes, the league is being well received. We're seeing great crowds. Cincinnati was mentioned, 30,000, their first ever game, I think, last week, which is an incredible turnout. They won't maintain those numbers, but even if they got, you know, half of that on a weekly basis, it's still a solid attendance each week from which to build your club. The only problem is that you can only build to a certain level, and you can't. There's nowhere to go once you reach the top of the USL. That's it. So while things are being run well in outside of Major League Soccer within professional football in the USA, it's not really going to be a shining beacon or an example for anyone else to follow because the two structures are completely alien to each other.
You've got to feel sorry for the poor guy, though. This is Dan Carroll. You've got to feel sorry for him because there he is in Louisville, Kentucky. I'm not saying it's not wonderful out there. It's probably better sunshine than over here. And also the home of Muhammad Ali, as we've already said. But you've got to feel sorry for him that he's covering sort of like lower league, Louisville City FC, getting 8,000 crowds. And
it's a new development. It's a fascinating moment, you know, because he's got that. This is something new, dynamic, which is working. My professional suggestion for him would be to go out and steal as many bicycles as he can.
Because Muhammad Ali.
Exactly. He took up boxing because someone stole his bicycle. And he was the greatest.
He was.
Only 22 years old. He just whooped Sonny Liston. Didn't have a mark on his face. He talks to God every day. He must be the greatest.
Well, let's ask Dan Carroll himself. Dan, how many bikes have you stolen in Louisville, Kentucky? Are you the greatest or not?
none yet, but they just started a bike share program here. I think they've got them in London. I know they have them in New York, where I'm originally from. And those, I guess if I knew how to pick a lock, maybe I could get those.
I apologize. I apologize. Tim accusing you of criminality there is not on at all. I apologize for having to repeat that accusation. And don't try this at home, folks. But what you can tell us, and they've just answered your questions eloquently, what's it like, though, covering football of Louisville City, amongst other things, in this new, brave new world that's emerging in America?
Yeah, it's interesting. I actually, and Paul knows my background a little through, you know, social media, but I used to cover Major League Soccer. When I lived in New York, I covered the New York Red Bulls. So I have a little bit of a different perspective because I've seen the highest level here in the U.S. I've covered a few U.S., you know, men's national team games too, so I've seen that level. But I think it's like what Tim said. It's an exciting time. There is a passionate. It's not, you know, not huge, but there's a small and growing every week, it seems, passionate fan base here in Louisville for this team. I think their first year, 3 years ago, they averaged 6,000. Last year was 7,000. Now they're up to 8,000. Cincinnati started out last year and pretty much averaged for regular league matches about 20,000 per game. For the big ones, like the cup games, they've been averaging 30,000. They're playing Valencia on Monday in a friendly, and I think they're expecting another 30,000 crowd again. So that seems to be growing every day. But as Paul said, you know, there is sort of the issue of, you know, where do you go once you win the title? You know, there's nowhere to go but up, or nowhere to go because there's no promotion relegation. So really the only way to go up is to have an ownership group that has billions of dollars that can pay, you know, right now about $200 million expansion fee to get into Major League Soccer. And then by doing that, then you are, you know, able to get into a higher, you know, level of play, more money, more sponsorships, things like that. So you kind of have to buy your way in right now. But I think it's still, you know, a growing soccer community. I'm speaking to people, you know, every week and explaining the game to them. You know, cause, I mean, I grew up playing it and, you know, my whole life still play it, you know, with friends and stuff. So it's a growing sport here in America, and it's a perfect time for a city like Louisville, which has around 1 million people in the, you know, metro area, to latch onto the sport.
Look, I know that both Tim and Paul may have questions for you, but if I could just ask a last question. You say in your email that since listening to the World Football Phoning podcast in the last 8 to 10 years, since then you have both moved from home. You've gone to college. You moved away from home. You've gotten a job. And more importantly, you've gotten married. Congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah, I actually just got married 3 weeks ago, four weeks ago, yeah.
No, I was saying congratulations for going to college. Oh, you got married as well.
Of course, Don, of course.
No, congratulations, really, congratulations. Anyway, over to you guys. You got any questions for this budding young girl? Oh, we're running out of time. You got to make it quick, guys.
I have a quick question. What would be the kind of social and racial profile of those who are getting interested in football in your part of the world?
That's a good question. I would say it definitely leans more towards yuppies, I guess, millennials, as they're called out here. So anybody within the sort of 18 to 35 range, let's say, it definitely seems to be a little more Caucasian, I guess, than African American, but there's definitely plenty of, you know, Hispanic, Latin American descent. I do see African American people at games or playing soccer on the weekends too. So I think it's definitely a young sport, a young person sport, I guess, in terms of America, who watches and who, you know, is active in it. If that answers your question.
Yeah, and Paul.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's a growing sport across the U.S., but certainly in Louisville, could you ever see a situation where football at least competes with the cards in college football or college basketball? I know those are the two huge sports, really well followed sports over there.
A yes or no will do.
Yeah, I'm impressed. You know that. Yeah, cards. The Louisville Cardinals college football and basketball is king in this town, as is the Kentucky Wildcats. Dan, basketball and football, big rivals. Oh, go ahead. Dan,
you are the greatest. Thank you, Dan. It's been great. Thank you very much.
A pleasure. Thank you.
You're listening to a BBC Five Live podcast.
If you like this, you might also like this.
Eye of the Storm with Emma Barnett.
Every day we're covering some sort of storm that changes people's lives forever. To find out more about our range of podcasts, click, tap or swipe bbc.co.uk/5live.
So we're talking football in Europe and South America this morning with the Galatasaray's Paul Serres on the one side, taking care of any questions you've got on European football and players from over there playing our leagues, and the Legendinho Tim Vickery on the other side, although this side of the water this week. Well, welcome home, Tim. What brings you over this side, by the way?
Psychological necessity, I think.
I thought so. That's exactly what I thought. And he's come over to talk about South American football and players from over there playing in our leagues. This is a good question for both of you, from Graham in Vancouver. Stroke Inverness, I like that. He says, and you can't say not winning, okay? Please, leave that joke out for this one. Serious question. What makes a bad manager bad? Is it A, poor understanding of tactics, B, poor personal stroke man management abilities, C, lack of a work ethic, D, stubbornness to an old way of playing from their day, in other words, refusing to evolve with the times. E, or have I done E? A, B, C, D.
Yeah, no, that
e,
was B.
Yeah, that was D. So this is E, something else. And F, a combination of the above. So we spent all our time saying, let's leave the F out of it, though. Which is the... No, because we know. Yeah, okay.
We can't leave do that,
it. I know why Vickery is laughing. Get to the back of the class, Vickery. Leave the teacher alone now. It just came out like that.
You're not going to make the 96 that way, are you?
I know. It just came out like that. But if we do A to E, which is the most significant ingredient of making a bad manager bad? In fact, we'll start with the guy at the top of the class for this morning, Paul Serres.
Yes, good morning. Can you give me a prompt as to what A was again? It was... Yeah.
Poor understanding of tactics?
Well, it's not that. Yeah. I mean, it's not that.
It could be something completely different from what he's given.
Yeah, I mean, it just can't be that. You have to have your professional badges now to be able to coach in a professional club in the UK and throughout most of Europe as well. So... You know, the idea that a manager is tactically naive is a fallacy, really, because, yeah, OK, manager A may not be as tactically astute as manager B. He may not have the tactical awareness to be able to negate what manager B is trying to do. But to suggest, as is often the case, that a manager is tactically clueless, I mean, it's actually an impossibility.
He hasn't quite said that, though, has he? I mean, I know what you're saying, but supposing in a match there are two managers and it's a tactical battle between the two managers, one gets the upper hand. Couldn't you argue that for the other one, it's a poor understanding of the tactics?
Well, no. I mean, everybody is limited, you know, and if manager A loses out to manager B in a game of football, it doesn't make manager A useless or tactically, you know, very poor. It makes them not as good as the other guy. And there's a huge difference between somebody being not very good at something and somebody being not quite as good as the very best. You know, we tend to polarize since the advent of social media. You know, the social media ranking of footballers ranges from either amazing or terrible, and there's very little middle ground, it seems. And okay, you know, a manager comes up against a Guardiola or a Mourinho or a Conte and they lose, which most did last year. Some of the criticisms being leveled at said manager are way beyond you know what they should be. But I think that's a cultural, that's a societal issue rather than a football one.
What about the one that he says, which caught my attention most of all? The stubborn. Well, no, actually, it was D. Yeah, it was D. Yeah. Stubbornness to an old way of playing from their day, for example, or any other stubbornness. Yeah. you know, to a tactical formation, 4-4-2, 4-3-2.
That's the same as A, though, isn't it, really?
Is it really?
It's difficult to differentiate the two.
I don't know. I mean, this is another one, you know, you hear coaches being labelled as dinosaurs, or he's got no plan B, or, you know, another of the bullet points was, I think maybe it was a subpart of D, which was, you know, a loyalty to previous tactics that maybe worked at some point, and an inflexibility to try and move away from that to modernize, to move with the times. I think this is a key point. You know, I mean, look at Wenger at Arsenal. Wenger at Arsenal revolutionized the game when he came into the Premier League to take over. And within two decades, he's been left behind. And again, a lot of the criticisms from Arsenal supporters last year, some of it fair, some of it slightly over the top, but again, that's how it is, I think, these days, was that he has no plan B. Although we saw towards the end of the season that he went to a three at the back with Wenger at times. So, you know, I think we'll. It's a combination. I think it's a combination of most of them. But I think in terms of from a player's perspective, I think that it's point B, which was the lack of interpersonal skills
that's the most crucial then?
From a player's perspective, that's the most crucial. But I think it's an inflexibility, an inability to adapt their tactics to...
How about you, Tim?
I'm going with B as well. I mean, if the coach, he only really has three tasks, and he selects the team, he determines the strategy, and he sets the emotional tone in which the work takes place. And I think that three is probably the most important. And again, this comes from talking to players, the one who gets them to go the extra mile, the one who gets them to cover for a colleague. I also think that the wrong strategy done with conviction can be more successful than the right strategy done without conviction. And I think that the conviction comes from the coach. He has to be able, especially today, on the age of the sergeant major has gone, so he has to be able to persuade the players that the strategy which has been chosen is the best one. And if they follow this strategy, they will all win together and everyone will pick up their win bonus and everyone will share in the glory.
How difficult can that be?
Well, I think it's very hard.
Really?
Because you're dealing with a group of players. All right, you are selecting for the game. You're selecting 18. You've got 11 and you've got maybe 7 on the bench. In some places, you can have more on the bench. Straight away, you've got 7 there thinking, well, why hasn't he picked me? No, it's a tough job, you know. It's a really... And sticking that team sheet up on the wall and then dealing with the egos and the emotions and trying to keep all of them on side, it's a very, very tough, job. And I think that's the hardest part.
What is frustrating me when you say that is then you're saying that, oh, these managers are nothing special. They're just... good man managers. I mean,
That's something very, very special.
That was important at Charlton when Alan. I've declared my interest before. When Alan Kirbishley was manager of Charlton, you know, he was known for his man management. I get that, but then it undermines all the other skills that the guy is supposed to bring to the table as a manager, which includes tactics, which includes understanding of the other teams, and. May even include, you know,
it is difficult to separate the two because on let's say give the example of Antonio Conte coming in at Chelsea, and obviously he's done something tactically different as well. He didn't do it straight away, did he? And they lost a couple of games before he went with that line of three that proved so successful. So, you know, first of all, he's coming in with a little bit of humility, perhaps, there, saying to his players, all right, let's see the way that you've been doing it. Let's see if that works. Doesn't work. All right, now let's do it this way. Let's see if we're better doing it this way. And obviously, if he's telling them to do something absolutely stupid, no matter how much they like him, they're not going to they're not going to really believe in it. So it is difficult to separate the man management ability from the soundness of the strategy which is put before them.
Good example. And no doubt, you know, feel free to come back in to talk about this bad management thing. But let's bring Mike in Newark in New Jersey into the conversation. Mike, good morning.
Good morning to you, Doug. How are you? Good morning, Tim. Good morning, Paul.
Good morning.
Very well, thank you. And thanks for asking, Mike. Go ahead. You've got a question.
My question is basically surrounding, what the panelists may think about how much a country's population would basically have a bearing on the success of the national team. Now, obviously, we know that Brazil, Argentina, Germany are very successful with a strong population base. But then if you look at the United States, for instance, Russia, other big countries, you know, maybe perhaps not as successful. I can think of one big example. And the reason why I'm bringing this up is because in the United States, we seem to latch on to this theory that, well, it's only a matter of time before our, 300 million people will just steamroll the rest of the world and win the World Cup.
Now, they won't steamroll China, but I know what you mean, or India.
You're bringing up China and India, and it's kind of, with President Xi Jinping that seems to want to have this initiative of making China the global football superpower. I can just think of one real example the last World Cup when the United States played Belgium, I believe. United States, 300 million people playing against Belgium, 11 million people. Just played off the park. Belgium was just so much better than them. And we know, China just has very little profile. On top of that, I think, we see the success of Iceland in the European Championships, for instance. Another big thing with the United States is most of our players are coming from either California or New Jersey. Very few are coming from other parts of the United States. And this match against Belgium, I believe, featured four people who were actually born in Germany. Who would not really fit into that 300 million people anyway. So I just think, China is, they're very successful in women's football, as is the United States. I just don't see them being able to be better than Colombia or Uruguay. It seems like there's this huge gulf in class that remains between the emerging powers of, North America or Asia or Africa, for instance, and that of the traditional powers of Europe and South America, population notwithstanding, of course.
It's interesting. The essential question then, gentlemen, if I might paraphrase that, Mike, is what effect of population size has on national or the success of the national team? A really good question. We'll let Tim mention Uruguay in a moment, Paul, but first of all... First of all, though, and if you can make that comparison between football and Olympic teams, because in the Olympics, for my generation certainly, it did seem as if size, and this generation too, with the exception sometimes of Jamaica in sprint, it does seem as if size matters. The USA, China, and Russia are more likely to be at the top of the leaderboard in the Olympics, but not in terms of football. Why is that?
Well, what you used, Russia, China, and...
The United States.
Yeah, okay. Well, Russia and China, obviously, they have a legacy from communism. And, communist
big countries,
regimes.
They?
They are, but that's incidental. If you look at Romania in the 1980s, they won a Champions League. And also, they were a huge power in things like gymnastics and athletics throughout the 1980s. And they're not a particularly populous country. It's the emphasis on which the regime puts on sport in general as being a vehicle with which to prove the glory of the motherland, and we saw that with the USSR during the communist times, and we've seen they remain near the top of the leaderboards in Olympic games and things like that, but in other sports we've seen the decline, I think, from Russia. But I think to answer the question, it's not necessarily about the sheer weight of numbers that you have. Otherwise, China and India would be the preeminent powers in world football, and they're not. I think more important factors are the amount of money that government will throw at things like infrastructure, And also the education. And also, I think maybe more importantly, more important than however many 330 million people that live in the USA, how important football is as a sport in that particular country. I mean, China, football is not important. It's just not an important sport in Chinese culture. And it's not in the US either. So, I mean, this is a much fairer way of working out why the US are not as strong.
Are you saying then quality in depth, in numbers, is not an advantage? You know, the fact that you can find more quality the larger the right. sample size is not a factor.
Well, but that's not necessarily going to be the case. You know, what, 60 million people in Germany and 300 million in the US, how many people in Germany, certainly as kids, as young adults, play football? Probably more than in the US, despite the discrepancy in population. In the US, you have baseball, American football, you have ice hockey, basketball, you have track, you have
Just look at track. Are you really seriously suggesting that the fact that they have quantities in depth there, that it doesn't make a difference on the track?
It makes a difference, Dawn, but the difference that it makes is in their collegiate system. They have a bigger pool of high school athletes to choose from.
Yeah,
and they can choose the cream of the high schools, you know. And they're already, at 18 years old, they're already in an incredibly competitive environment. And that sort of infrastructure, yes, it's sort of because of the education system in the US. But so much emphasis is placed on sport, on college sport. You have 100,000 people going to watch American football games, what is essentially amateur sport. Yeah. You wouldn't get that anywhere else. But, 1.2 billion people in China, they've not qualified for a World Cup in 20 odd years or more.
So,
I
was just going to move on to Tim. Does size matter?
Oh, clearly, you'd rather be Brazil than Uruguay. You've got more players to pick from, and Paul's point is perfectly valid. And weight of population only counts if you've got to have a weight of population behind that particular sport. If not, you're like a country that has a big population but discriminates against women. You're only calling on 50% of your resources. So a size of population and the number of players that you have to pick from clearly is a factor. Tradition also. Obviously is a factor. One generation sets the bar for the next generations and it motivates and inspires, occasionally intimidates, but I think more motivates and inspires. You've got that as a role model to live up to, and I think that's very important. But culture is also very, very important. I'm fascinated by the years of the Cold War, the way that the Soviet bloc really looked at football. Really looked at sport as an area of national prestige. And they were so successful in so many things. And I know that in football, Hungary had a great side. And they had a great side until the 66 World Cup. Poland were great from the kind of early to mid-70s until the mid-80s. But in general, you look at what the Soviet bloc and East Germany, the Soviet Union, what they were doing in athletics and other sports, and you compare it with what they were doing in football, and it's clear that what worked in other fields didn't work so well in football. Part of that may well be use of illegal substances, because football is a much more complex game, and it's a game that requires a long, long sequence of collective and individual decision making, and maybe that's harder for totalitarian cultures.
But maybe we don't have to go back to those days to look at the impact of numbers. And I'm sorry to cut you, but just fair enough. And the argument about Uruguay winning the early World Cups, we understand why a small country the size of Wales won the early World Cups when so many other countries didn't take part.
They were picking from all of their society.
Yeah, and a lot of other countries weren't taking part, crucially.
Yeah.
But when we look at a country like Spain that won those unprecedented three international championships, two World Cups, was it, and a European Championship in that time, from... an average-sized country, not a huge country whatsoever. What was the difference? What was it that made the difference then? That's a question for Paul as well, but Tim first.
It's an idea, and we have to, and this I have to hold my hands up and admit this kind of through gritted teeth and somewhat reluctantly, but it's true that by far the best football at the moment is played in Western Europe. And if you look at, say, the last three World Cups, only one finalist from outside Western Europe. That's one of the reasons that Belgium, you know, with a small population, can punch well above their weight. Because Western Europe is congregating the best football at club level and the best players at club level. And the best,
so Paul's right.
And the best ideas at club level. It's that network that you've got, that that exchange, that constant interchange, there's an easy way to show this, and that's England, and how far for a while English clubs fell off the pace when, as a result of the hooligan problem, English clubs were outside Europe before the ban in 85. The English clubs were the clubs to beat in the European Cup, as the Champions League then was.
Yeah.
You kick the English clubs out of Europe for a few years, they're out of the loop. When they come back, the things moved on.
Of course.
They're not the same anymore.
And of course,
so
Spain, the national team suffered as well.
Yeah. Although there was a very talented generation who did very well in the 1990 World Cup. So Spain are at the heart of that nexus there, where the ideas are flowing, the best players are flowing. They had a consistent idea,
right,
collective
then,
idea of play.
But then Paul's right, because it's about the organisation. It's not about the numbers. That's what you were saying a moment or two ago, wasn't it, Paul?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, what Tim, I mean, it's a complex question with complex answers. But, you know, what Tim said is right, too. You know, the best players are congregated in Western Europe. The best, the most money is in the game in Western Europe. And the best facilities are there in Western Europe. So, you know, it's if you provide your youth with the facilities and the coaching they need, I would take a country that does that right. For example, Iceland, who have had a philosophy and an idea for more than 10 years, you know, and it's come to fruition now with what we saw from them last year in the Euros and almost qualifying for World Cups and very possibly doing so, you know, again in the future. It's you know, 500,000 people live in Iceland, and I would take an Icelandic team as of right now over a Chinese national team or an Indian national team without a second thought. Mm-hmm. And it's not to do with sheer weight of numbers. It's to do with the organization and the, you know, you have to be able to say to a child or show a child that you have their development in mind. You have, look, this is you come and join our club at 6 years old. We have a pathway for you all the way through this club with the same coaching, with the same standards all the way through to the first team. There's a path there for you. Yeah. In China at the moment, you know, it's very, very difficult. I know that they've got quotas in place, but it must be very difficult to pull on the same shirt as Carlos Tevez or a Hulk or a player like that, and then and see at the end of the month that, you know, they're all going home in a brand new sports car, and you're struggling. This is similar in Major League Soccer too. Yeah. You know, the money that local players are paid is dwarfed by massive salaries for imports.
You know, interestingly enough, Alex in Glasgow says, for someone who has not kicked a ball in earnest, Tim Vickery makes a lot of sense regarding football. But Tom in Swansea's got a bone to pick with you, Tim. Do you know why?
No, go on.
Any ideas, Paul? The giveaway is the Swansea part. Remember, we're talking about international football here.
Jefferson Montero. He wants someone to take Jefferson Montero. I'll take him. I'll stand him in the living room.
International football.
Well, Wales. Wales.
Yeah. So what did Tim say that Tom's got a bone to pick with?
Did I say England when I meant Britain when
been? No, nothing.
I've got a mate's mum who used to phone the BBC every 5 minutes because said England and you meant Britain.
Yeah, you've been away too long, mate. No, it's Belgium punched well above their weight. Did you not? Oh, let me do this in a Welsh accent.
Belgium punched well above their weight, but we were talking up. We were talking about the World Cup. But we were not talking about the European Championship.
Did you not see the... This is a Nigerian from Wales, by the way. Did you not see... It's terrible, I can't do it. Did you not see a Nigerian from Wales that is a member of the Adebayo family? Did you not see the absolute pummeling the Welsh gave the Belgians? Did
so
you
very, very good game. Very good game. Yeah. Could have gone either way. Congratulations to the Welsh.
Okay, just getting that
Gareth Bale.
Okay. You do the accent.
Oh, England.
I'm going to have to quote Dylan Thomas in a moment or two. Under Milkwood. Oh, Richard Burton was
spirits from the very deep.
We could be here all night, but it's not unusual, you know that.
You're listening to a BBC Five Live podcast.
If you like this, you might also like this.
Flintoff, Savage and the Ping Pong Guy.
Is everybody's hunger in sport different?
I was hungry. I wanted to be the best. For me, you win or that's it.
To find out more about our range of podcasts, click, tap or swipe bbc.co.uk/5live.
Up all night with Dotun Adebayo.
It's not unusual to be loved by anyone. It's not unusual to have fun with anyone. But when I see you hanging around with anyone, it's not unusual to see me cry.
Yeah.
I wanna die.
Yeah. Fair enough, Tim. Fair enough. I see that you've learned some moves since you've been in Brazil. You've learned some moves. It's just a shame
Tom,
about
you know,
the singing.
Just gets it out of you.
Shame about the singing.
And it's obviously, you know, it's a combination of Tom and coming back to the green, green grass of home.
you won't let it go, will you? You won't let it go. One listener emails to say they're not happy with you suggesting that Belgium punch above their weight in comparison to Wales, and you won't let the accent go as a result of that. Anyway, shame about the singing is what I was going to say. And talking of Wales... Guess who we've got on the phone?
It's not Tom Jones, is it?
No, we've got Bibeto, clearly.
No, we haven't got Bibeto, got somebody in Suffolk.
What's that got to do with Wales?
Dylan, in Suffolk. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to you, mate. How are you?
Good morning. I'm great. I love listening to the show. I've been listening for 10 years now, so...
Oh, well done, mate. Yeah. Well done. Really appreciate that.
And if you knew what my second name was, you'd... think how ironic it was. You said you needed to quote a bit of Dylan Thomas a minute ago. So,
Well done, you. Full marks.
I won't go down there. Anyway, the question. the question I wanted to ask is a question for Tim. And I might be slightly wrong here. So, in the 1930s, a Man United player and a couple of other English players sort of eloped to Colombia. Because they were paying big money. I think they could earn £8 a week. And I think it happened after United had just done a tour of the United States. So I'm thinking about 1930. So a few players went over to Colombia. And because they went and played in Colombia, the FA banned them on their return. Can you tell me the exact story of that? And also why? Because it seemed to happen for a really brief period. So why and how did Colombia have the money to offer foreign players to come over, and just what was all that about?
It's a little bit later than you thought. It's end of the 40s, start of the 50s. Amongst the English players who went over, there was Charlie Mitten of United, and England's centre-half, Neil Franklin, who on some rate as the greatest centre-half that English football ever came up with. What happened was that Colombia launched a professional league, and there was an internal row in Colombia. This professional league was launched outside the auspices of the Colombian FA. Now, that meant that this league wasn't affiliated to FIFA. So it was a pirate league, which meant that because it was outside FIFA, they didn't have to pay any transfer fees. They could do just what they wanted, you know. All they had to say was, all right, we're going to pay you this. Come on, no transfer fees. One of the clubs, Santa Fe in Bogota, who tragically, I've never understood why, they play in Arsenal shirts, and it's an Anglophile club. They grew up with a thing of love in England, and they were the club that got in these English players. But it wasn't just English players; lots came in from Uruguay, lots came in from Peru, and especially from Argentina. Argentina at this time, the players went on strike in Argentina, and this is when Argentine football is at its absolute golden age. So Argentina players went on strike, so the Colombians just thought, well, why don't we just go down there and bring them all up? So they did, including Di Stefano. And Di Stefano, who then went on later to join Real Madrid and launched the European Cup, now the Champions League, and was its undoubted star. And some people rate Di Stefano as the greatest player of all time. And his idol, and Di Stefano went to Colombia as a young man, his idol Pedernera went there as well, the Napoleon of football. So they had the best players in Argentina, and especially in the rivals of Santa Fe, Millonarios in Colombia, who Di Stefano Pedernera played for. They may well have been the best side in the world at that time, all based on the fact that they didn't have to pay any transfer fees. It's known in Colombia as the El Dorado era. You know, when it really was, what a fantastic way to launch your professional league. Imagine if when Major League Soccer launched in 1996, imagine if they managed to get the best players in the world suddenly. So you got a crowd watching the best players in the world. Absolutely fantastic. A fantastic start to the Colombian league. But obviously it couldn't go on. And in the end, a kind of deal was done with FIFA where the Colombian League and Colombian football kind of rejoined FIFA, and the players, after a certain amount of time, they had to go home. The English didn't last very long, at all, and they found it quite hard to adjust, I think. And this was at a time when England was a much, much more limited country in terms of food and so on than it is these days. So, you know, it was also a very, very turbulent political environment going on in Colombia, which is one of the reasons that people were looking to invest in football, to give something people something other than kind of revolution to get on with. So the players didn't last very long, but yes, they did get banned by the FA, which is really, really cruel. And Alf Ramsey, who was a player in the England team at that time, and obviously later became the England manager, in his autobiography, he goes out of his way not to mention Neil Franklin, because he was just so angry with the fact that the England centre-half had gone chasing some Colombian gold. But they earned a little bit of money, and good luck to them.
£8 a week. Can you confirm that?
No. Well, they wouldn't have got paid in pounds, I think. They would have got paid in local currency. But anyway, the point is, they could earn much, much more in Colombia than they could in English football. And the clear comparison you make from that, and the clear conclusion that you make from that, is that English football, for years and years and years, on decades upon decades upon decades, was playing paying the players an absolute pittance compared to what they were worth. So it's just a point to remember when people complain about the admittedly absurd amounts that footballers get paid these days, that for so many years, footballers were exploited.
Okay. Dylan, thanks a lot. What a great questioner, actually, and gave us the opportunity to get a bit of culture and history into the programme as well, because it's lacked it until then, of course, with all this Welsh accents and business. This is a question, though. A question from Seb, for both of you. It's a good question, I reckon. Oh, by the way, Keith says, great talk again today, worth waiting up for. So he obviously liked the Welsh accent. Not sure if he liked the declaration of an interest, by the way, Paul. But, you know, he says it's worth waiting up for, or waking up for, rather than waiting up for. Anyway, Seb's question, let me get onto that. He says he's a Chelsea fan. Can either of you tell us of any other team which have such a good youth record, but none of the youth team can break into the first team? Isn't that a good question, Paul?
It is a good question, and I mean, the short answer to that is no, because
what we've seen from the Chelsea FA Youth Cup winning side three seasons in a row, I think it is now. What we've seen from Chelsea over recent years is that they're utterly dominant at that level. It's great for Chelsea to have such a strong youth contingent, but only really if they then go on to at least make the club some money or ideally to play in the first team and make that natural progression through from the youth system into the first team. But, you know, this links, I suppose, in a way to the question about size of population against facilities that the population has to use to try and develop. And we've seen in recent years, we've seen clubs like Chelsea, not just Chelsea, far from it, but Chelsea, Manchester City, other teams really invest not just in facilities, but in players, buying players for often millions of pounds at 16 or 17 years old. And, you know, every summer, it seems, there are articles written about the number of players that Chelsea have out on loan, 30 or 40 last year. This monopolization on young talent, not just from the local area anymore, as it used to be, but Europe-wide and worldwide has brought about this sort of unique situation mm-hmm. where Chelsea have this wealth of talent that can't get in the first team. And you know, this goes back to last week as well, Dom, when we were speaking about what makes a good manager, mm-hmm. and we were talking about winning and about how it doesn't matter how good a coach you are. You're only ever sort of three defeats away from losing your job. It doesn't matter what you've done last.
I forgot that last week we talked about what makes a good manager, and this week we've talked about what makes a bad manager.
Makes a bad one. Yeah.
Tim, any side like that, like Chelsea?
Not at all, because as we were saying earlier on, it's an export industry, really.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're producing in order to sell,
okay.
which means that you get them in the first team because they're in the shop window. This is a problem of the big European clubs stockpiling talent.
Yeah. This question by email is from Dixon. It's not a bad question, actually. I want to ask, you're going to have to declare an interest here, Paul. I want to ask Paul and Tim a question about the model of Manchester City that I'm struggling to understand. I was watching the friendly derby last night, and when I saw players like Mangala and Nasri, it made me wonder. These players were bought with huge sums of money, and City can't resell them without a loss. Even when they're loaned out, City still have to do a part payment of their wages, and that goes as well for their goalkeeper, doesn't it? Joe mm-hmm. Hart. Bearing in mind players like Navas, Cliche, you get me confused with my French, Zabaleta, Caballero, all left for free at the end of the season. Hart is going out on loan, which I presume City will have to do a part payment of his wages as well. Now City need to strengthen, so they're buying huge again. Walker and hopefully left back, I understand fully. But the potential signing of Danilo from Madrid as a backup to Walker makes me wonder, how feasible is this model in the long term, both on the field of play and financially for the club, or any club for that matter?
How feasible is it in the long term? I mean, City have gone from being under financial fair play punishment to being, I think, third or fourth in terms of revenue turnover, biggest club in Europe last season. So, you know, it's sustainable in as far as the early days after the takeover saw City splashing money around and then had to tighten the belt a bit when it came to to financial fair play and adhering to the regulations of that, which they fell foul of course, as did PSG and a number of other teams. Sustainable long term, I suppose it's as sustainable as the current television deal is sustainable. We're seeing a situation now where fewer and fewer people are watching Premier League football, watching football from all over in the traditional way. I mean, not going to the game, the traditional way of watching on TV. And we saw a freedom of information request by the BBC last week asking about illegal streams. And a third of people now watch Premier League football illegally because for a number of reasons. You know, subscriptions are expensive, or the game that they want to watch that weekend is a 3 o'clock Saturday afternoon game and you can't watch it in the UK. By law, it's forbidden. So you jump onto the computer and you can easily find a stream from elsewhere of said game.
I don't think that the current financial television rights deal is sustainable in its current form. I think after we see the, you know, it's only just come in, but once we see this one, the contract is up, I think we'll see a very different, and Sky are already trying to do it now with their sports-specific channels that they've just introduced. They're trying to make it more, you know, more cheap, basically, for people to watch the sport that they want.
Isn't that something of a different issue, though? Because with Manchester City, they've got bags and bags and bags of money.
But it's not that simple, Dotun, because you can't just spend bags and bags of money.
I know.
Adhere to financial fair play regulations.
But
you can only spend a certain amount of your turnover.
Yeah.
You have to be self-sustaining. So nobody's going to be able to throw their own personal money at it. Saying the majority of their income now for big clubs is coming from TV. And with the changing consumption habits of viewers, I cannot see television deals increasing
No, but what will happen? But what will happen is that all the transfer fees will come down at that point, won't it? Won't then? It will be the same for all teams. Whereas Manchester City are still financially more able to have lost leaders, if you like, than any other club.
Well, I mean, theoretically, I suppose so. But what we see when television deals have to be restructured, when people want to consume football not via TV, you know, they want to watch on their laptop or on their phone or whatever, we will see a situation where, you know, it doesn't just end. It's not just the end of that. There are still wages to be paid for contracts that were signed when hundreds of billions of pounds were coming into every club every year. So, it's not gonna fall away as it rose. It's gonna crash, I think. And this kind of thing is sustainable for as long as football, the finances in football are sustainable. And I don't think that is, for, you know, in the current climate, I don't think it will be very long that is sustainable for.
I suppose from a South American perspective, Tim, it's a plague on all your houses. They made worms meat out of us.
Well, you know, there is all of this money, which and it does circulate. And when it circulates inside the game, then so be it. And for example, at the moment, Santos in Brazil are kind of hoping that Neymar does switch from Barcelona to Paris Saint-Germain because they'll get a cut. They'll get a nice development cut. I'm absolutely fascinated there listening to Paul about the future of TV rights, because this is something that I've thought about myself. And obviously, Paul's much closer to being down with the kids than I am with his new consumption habits. But I've often wondered about the sustainability of TV rights in an internet age. So I found that absolutely fascinating.
Yeah. Okay. What changes will Sampoli make for Argentina, and who will play with Messi up front? Asked Darren in London.
Well, it's
briefly, please.
He's had a couple of games, and I think we will see a change to a back three. There'll be changes of personnel there as well, and he'll get them playing in the opposing half of the field. I wouldn't be surprised if Paredes of Roma comes in and plays a role in midfield. Vital game for them coming up at the end of next month away to Uruguay. What a game that's going to be.
Okay. Paul, this is a question from a listener who says, Everton plays Slovakia side Ruzom Biroc in Europa League, and I have no idea about this team. Can you tell us anything more about them?
The short answer to that really is no.
No, although, I thought so.
I would say come back to me, because I've read something about them today. They were involved in... I don't know. It's gone. But I was reading about them today. But I think it's their first season in European competition.
Okay. Could you ask Paul about Jonathan Vieira of Las Palmas? Tom in Swansea wasn't here.
What about him? Lovely, beautiful, beautiful footballer. Just the kind of, you know, you think Spanish attacking player, and you know, he fits that mold really. He's technically outstanding, brilliant on the ball, great passer of a ball. He'll find a pass where mere mortals can't really find one. He's, I suppose, criticisms are lack of a defensive work rate. I would love to see him, you know, play as an attacking midfielder, but I think his work rate isn't anywhere near enough to warrant that, and that's why he's been stuck out on the left. To great effect, by the way, but for a lot of his career so far. But if he comes to the Premier League, I think that he's the kind of player that would make a real impact.
And Tim, why this is from Jake, why did the Brazilian Fernando Martins move back to Russia following a season in Italy? Was he simply not good enough or something more?
Yeah, he's almost become a forgotten man. And this is a burly defensive midfielder who was in the Confederations Cup squad of 2013, moved to Russia, and it seems then in Brazil he has just been totally forgotten and clearly hasn't made the progress expected of him.
And what have the Colombians done with Ganso, and will any Brazilian club...
The Colombians done with Ganso?
Okay.
He's gone to Sevilla. He's been at Sevilla in Spain.
Okay. Well, the other question, will any Brazilian club pay the quote-unquote ransom to bring him home?
No, well, he's talking about knuckling. Sevilla have a new coach, the Argentine bid it, so taking over from Sampaoli, who's taken over the Argentine national team job. So I suppose it's a fresh start. And he's something of an old-fashioned put-your-foot-on-the-ball playmaker. He's coming up 28, and he's in real problems of going from promising youngster to grizzled veteran with absolutely nothing in between. And he's talking about how hard it's been to adapt. And the big thing he has to adapt to is to the idea of passing and then moving, rather than passing and just admiring the pass he's just played.
One for each of you from Carlon. Who's been the most surprising player in your regions who has gained an international cap? The most surprising, Paul?
Ooh. God.
Have a think, Tim.
Yeah, it's a hell of a question for five to four in the morning.
A central midfielder called Souza, who Brazilian, who went to Turkey. I don't know where he is now.
He's at Fenerbahce.
Just a plodding mediocrity. I'm not a bad player, but for crying out loud, if you're going to play central midfield for Brazil, you know, have a little bit about you.
I know. I was laughing because I was thinking, Paul couldn't answer the question to him, but he can answer yours. Can we swap? Can I throw one at you, Tim? There's
no football. You're going to throw things at me anyway.
I know, of course I am. Burnley have been linked with Gonzalo Escalante. Could you ask Tim about him, please?
Well, I'm going to flick this one over to Paul because I don't think he played 10 games in South America for Boca, right-sided midfielder, before he moved to Europe. I think he's been in Spain and in Italy. So I can happily giggle away and throw this one over to Paul.
Yeah, he played for Eibar the last couple of years, and he's been excellent since he moved to Eibar. He scores a lot of goals from midfield, and still young. 23, I think he is, 24, but he's really impressed me since he moved to Eibar in 2015, I think, from one of the smaller clubs in Italy.
In the spirit of your foreign exchange, I suppose we have to throw this one to Tim. It's from James. It says, Paul, what are your thoughts on Reece Oxford going on loan abroad? I've seen a lot of mixed reactions, and I don't understand why. Tim?
I have no mixed reactions. I think it's an excellent thing, picking up experience, and I'm sure Paul will agree.
I do completely agree. However, in this instance, he's only 18.
With eyes that would glow?
I know, that's a song. Yeah. Don't worry about that. Yeah.
No, I know. And, you know, if he's going to go abroad to play, if he's going to go on loan, so he's gone to Gladbach, if he's going to go out there and play 15, 20 league games and get experience that he wouldn't get here, great. But I don't think he will. I don't think he'll play very much. And then his experience becomes a personal, cultural one rather than a really meaningful... He will learn a lot, of course, but... He really needs to be getting kicked around the pitch by gnarled old pros by now if he's going to really make it as the player that we hope he will be.
George says Pep Guardiola said recently that junior players are better off staying and learning their trade in the reserves into their 20s instead of going on loan. Do either of you agree? Tim first.
I think it's not a one-size-fits-all thing. And some players benefit from the experience of going on loan and getting in the first team. I always think that getting in the first team is the place to be, when it matters, when there's points at stake, when there's a crowd there. The loan thing worries me more when it's someone coming in from another country. Like we're criticising Chelsea for doing it, but a lot of clubs do it. So you bring them in from South America, you park them here for 6 months, and then there for 6 months, and then there for 6 months, and they don't feel important at any of those places. They're disorientated, and I don't think that works.
Paul?
Sorry, was that the loan question?
Yeah.
I mean, like I said, I
are
think
you paying
if he
attention,
goes...
Paul?
I already answered this one.
You've only got a minute and a half to go. You've been distracted
I answered
already.
This one, then you gave it to Tim, and then you came back to me.
No,
You want me to repeat myself? No.
Defend yourself at all times.
Well, no, but, you know, is it better for them to stay in the under-20s? What was it? In the reserves. Yeah, different question.
I mean, it depends, Dotun, it depends. If a player is going to, you know, has a 95% chance of making it in the first team at one of these clubs, at one of the major clubs, then yes, because you learn, you know, not only are you learning your trade, but you're learning it specifically to that club and to the way they want you to play throughout the age groups. If you stay, you know, we've got a lot of players that have been released by clubs 20, 21 years old who will struggle to find a way back in. And maybe if they'd gone to Margate or Morecambe or somewhere, not necessarily by the seaside, but somewhere in the lower leagues at 17 or 18, then their career path may have been completely different. But of course, if somebody offers you a contract on £5,000 a week at 17 years old, who's going to say no to that?
On a day like today, we while the time away, writing love letters in the sand, the seaside sand. You saw where I was going with that. Tim, thanks very much. Paul, thanks very much. How long are you going to be over here for, Tim?
Just over 2 weeks.
Okay. Thanks very much.
On digital and online.
This is BBC Radio 5 Live.
bbc.co.uk/5live.